A very good afternoon and a warm welcome to our students of PGDM Batch 2021 who are all geared up to start their journey at Asian Business School. What better would a start be than to meet people who were once amongst you 8-9 years back and today are one of the epitome of success in their respective fields. This success isn't ordinary students, I must tell. We are so happy to inform that these buds of ABS are gigantic part of the most renowned MNCs and have not just flagged ABS in India, but have taken it overseas, working successfully at the international borders as well. With this, I proudly welcome each one of you to ABS Impact Alumni Talk Series. This is a very unique program and event where you get a chance to learn from the experiences of successful professionals who were once amongst you, the alumni of Asian Business School. It is indeed my great pleasure to welcome amongst us the alumni of this institution. Not only is it a moment of happiness and nostalgia for us, but also an opportunity to reflect on their learnings and achievements. Our alumni have established themselves as successful individuals in almost every field of their lives, and we could be no prouder or no less prouder. A school or college is a second home for children, and it plays a vital role in nurturing them into good human beings, rather professionals. Besides shaping the character of a student, it helps him to face the world with bravery, courage, and the requisite skill set. And here we have them all practicing the values which they learned from this institution. Let me introduce to you all our guests of honor, our very own students. We have amongst us Rashmi Verma. Rashmi is one of our students amongst many who are well settled and working in Dubai, which probably today has got best career opportunities to offer. Rashmi holds 7 years of enriching experience in marketing and product management. Currently, she is working with Samsung Gulf product management team as a specialist responsible for sales and marketing budget management for P&L. Previously, she has worked with B. Blunt Dubai Unilever Joint Ventures, HFS. We welcome you, Rashmi, once again to ABS.
Thank you so much, Garima. So I started my journey with Hindustan Field Services as a management trainee. It was a campus placement, and I'm really thankful to ABS that they gave me the opportunity to learn everything about marketing. My initial profile was handling the retail operations and retail marketing for Unilever brands. And now I'm working with Samsung, handling the sales and marketing budget and their P&L. Yeah, it's been a great journey since I started as a management trainee and today I'm a specialist. So I'm really thankful to ABS. They gave me the opportunity to learn, you know, get immense knowledge about retail operations. So thank you for having me here today.
We thank you for being part of us once again and welcome to you. We also have amongst us Pulkit Chaudhary. Pulkit has recently started working with Coca-Cola at their Center of Excellence as a manager DME controls for Russia, Belarus, Ukraine, and Moldova. He is handling their complete direct marketing expense budget for all the Coke brands in our UBM countries. Before Coke, he has worked with JP Morgan as a senior financial analyst for their commercial banking business, analyzing companies which had turnover between $500 million to $2 billion. We welcome you, Pulkit, at ABS.
Thank you so much, Garima ma'am. So firstly, it has been an honor because I still remember my days from ABS campus when we used to sit as an audience and look at the professionals who used to speak. And to be frank, even I was someone who used to, you know, get inspired and wanted to do something like that. And you have given me this opportunity, which is great. So, yes, you rightly said I currently work with Coca-Cola. I've recently joined them handling their RUBM business, that is Russia, Belarus, Ukraine, and Moldova. And previously, I have worked with various companies, all in finance, best of the names. And I started my career with MRE Prize, which was a campus placement to me. And from there till now, it has been a journey with my numbers, and I'm pretty happy with those. So thank you so much for having me here.
Great, pleasure is all ours, and we are very, very proud of your achievements. Thank you so much for coming and joining us and guiding our students, of course. We have amongst us Avantika Tiwari. Avantika is currently working as the Manager Human Resource Data Flow. She started her career with Insight Alpha as a research associate, post which she worked with Maven Workforce as a recruitment specialist. She has been working on diverse functions under the HR umbrella. Welcome to ABS, Avantika.
Thank you so much, Garima ma'am. So it's honestly a pleasure and an honor to be here addressing the new folks who will be doing PGDM. So it doesn't seem that it's almost 7 years that we have passed our PGDM, and we are here addressing new folks who will be starting their career with the professional journey career with ABS. So it has been a great pleasure to be here. So yes, I started my career with Insight Alpha, which was again a campus placement. And if I remember correctly, I was the first person to get placed there. And thus I didn't want to lose that opportunity. And I started from there. So it was a good journey there. And currently I am working with Dataflow. So I started with a recruiter, which is initially called as the main profile of an HR, but currently at the offsite that I'm currently working at, I am currently handling the entire domain of HR, which is very interesting, to be very honest, but at the same time, you get to know what's the market all around. So that's a good journey, and I'm thankful to ABS that they have like grown up me in that sense that I can be here where I am today. So thank you so much for that.
Thank you so much for being here. Pleasure is all ours. And I think with this, let us start with our series and the alumni talk, for which our students are really very excited. I would take a minute to speak something about this batch, actually. We've had a couple of competitions even before they started their session with us, which is related to their entrepreneurship or their talent. And I must say one thing, that each one of them is thoroughly, thoroughly, very sincere, very, very inquisitive. And hence, they flooded us with so many questions about their future, about ABS, about what to go for in their particular domains and how to select the domain and so on. I think you people would be the best judges for that, best people who can guide them rather. So if with your permission, I think let's start with a little Q&A and talk about these students who want to ask their questions. Shall we go ahead?
Yeah, sure.
Yes.
Great. So to start with, I think the most popular question, and this one is coming from Yogita and Apoorv, that we are about to start our journey at ABS. We would like to know, how was your overall experience at ABS, and how do you think the college helped you to prepare for the real corporate world? And how has ABS as an institution helped you achieve where you are right now? So let's start with you, Pulkit. What is your take on that?
All right. So I still remember my days when I was researching to, took up a course in finance, because my interest was always in finance. Mm-hmm. So I was a graduate and I didn't have much time to spare to understand, do CA, spending 5 years. So PGDM was something that I felt like in 2 years, I can get a professional degree, which would be giving me an edge over all the graduates with me. So mm-hmm. that was one thing that I have into my consideration. Second, being from a finance background, being someone who loves finance, I always calculate everything on investment and return basis. So mm-hmm. when I was deciding on my PGDM, what is that I'm going to invest and what will be my future returns? That was the second thing that I was looking at. And ABS for some reason fit in all the buckets when I was looking out for. I won't say that ABS was the only school. There were many other schools that was under my consideration. Right. But when I looked at the investment and the return analysis, I think ABS was the best match. And that's how I decided to pursue with ABS.
And I think in ABS, journey is not just about the academics, because it gives you, you know, lots of, you will get lots of guest lectures, you will have industrial visits. So you will have that experience, that, you know, practical knowledge that corporate world is about. So it wasn't just about, you know, academics, books, or the knowledge in what we have in books. It's also about the practical knowledge that we get when we interact with the guest lecturers, or we have, you know, industrial visit, or let's say the Oxford trip, where you get to interact with the international, you know, lecturers or students.
Right. So
it is a very good journey, very beautiful journey, I would say. And you will get to learn, you will get to, you know, interact and be a part of very corporate world also.
Great. What about you, Vantika? So how would you define your journey at ABS?
So at ABS, yes, I would say the focus is on academics, and which ideally I think that all the colleges and institutes should focus. That's the primary motto that we join in a college in that sense. But the best part that I liked about ABS was that along with academics, there were a lot many other activities that was involved. Yes, like Rashmi said, industrial visits, guest lectures. But apart from that, there were many activities that were happening on a regular basis, which actually help us to, one, develop a competitive spirit within us and fight for our own self and see where we are. Along with our academics, they also helped us to grow ourselves, probably for the corporate world, because when we go out in the market, what actually people look into us is the overall package that they get. It's not only the academics that we see. So that's what I think that ABS gave us the most, and because of which we all, where we are today, we are. That's what I will add to it.
Right. So Avantika, as you mentioned, that when we go out in that corporate world, probably they're looking at the whole package. Yes, who you are presenting yourself as. So we are going to come to that, because students are really curious to know, you know, they step into this professional journey to see themselves well placed in future. So what can be done for that? We'll come to that. Before that, we have certain questions which have come up from Rashi, Gunika, Komal, Ekta, and Swati. All of them want to know, how important are those 2 years of PGDM for the overall personal as well as professional development? And did you face any challenges during these 2 years? Or what suggestions would you like to offer which can help us improve our learning experience? So Rashmi, what's your take on that?
So I would say how I prepared for the management studies, I think our lecturers in ABS, they're quite helpful. Even these students, my batchmates, I would say I'm not from, you know, accounts background or mathematics background. So it was Pulkit who helped me. So it's like the entire, it's not just about, you know, the friends that you have or the background you have. Sometimes your lecturers, your friends, your, you know, your partners will help you. So in terms of, you know, learning the entire thing, my batchmates, my lecturers, my professor, everybody was quite helpful. Definitely, we all do not come with the background who has, you know, management skills and everything. So I was the same. But within those 2 years, I learned a lot. I mean, we had for business communications also, we had, you know, mock calls, mock interviews. So everything was there in ABS. They helped us, you know, how to, you know, you have to be presentable. So be it a practical knowledge or be it, you know, academic knowledge, mm-hmm. everything was there. And every time there was somebody, professors, lecturers, everybody was there to help me. So it was very helpful journey.
Right.
Yeah.
Great. So I think it becomes difficult from the student point of view to decide which course to go for post you've done your bachelor's, because you usually choose your bachelor's course based upon your interest. But master's become a very, you know, a component where you research a lot and you become very careful about it. Yeah. So Avantika, Pulkit, Rashmi, tell me, how did you come to a conclusion that PGDM would be the right course? And then did it actually prove fruitful for your career where you are right now, or the entire progress that you've taken up?
Avantika, please go ahead.
So like Pulkit initially said that when we are actually finance graduates, we actually have in mind that CA is something that we would want to pursue and go through that. But there are times when we don't want to invest that much time and effort, and probably it depends on people as well, whether they want to go ahead and do CA or not, specifically if I talk about finance, because I was also a BCom graduate. So my initial target was to get into CA, but after investing a year or so, I thought, no, it's not good for me, because I can't spend that much hours into studies and just books, actually. So then I started looking out for other things, that what I should explore, whether I should go for maybe MCom or PGDM. But at that time, probably what striked into my mind was that one, when we are living with our parents, we always have a conservative environment. They always make us understand, this is good for you, this is bad for you, you should not do this, do that. But later, my perspective was that I should go out and study in a college, which is giving me one, exposure to the new world, where I can live alone and sustain myself, learn something new on myself, and take my own decisions. So then two things that come into picture is PGDM or an MBA. But I explored both the options, honestly speaking. I also got admission in JP for an MBA, but parallelly I was interviewed here in ABS for PGDM. But the way I was interviewed here, the way people dealt with me, the way it was holistic, how it was shown to me as a picture that this is an PGDM course and where you can learn a lot of things, actually that probably forced me to go ahead with a PGDM course with ABS. I still remember Gurdeep sir took my interview, and it was a very difficult interview. I would still say interview which I haven't had that complex in my corporate world, but actually, it enlightened me and gave me a thought that if people are so broad-minded and so probably knowledge that they have, and if I enter that college, and I'm sure I will get 50% at least out of it, if not 100%. So that was my thought of joining ABS and doing a PGDM course here.
Well, if 50% brings so much of incentive, like what you've got in the corporate world and achieved this height, I really can't imagine what 100% would have got. I'm sure you've taken 100%, Avantika, and displayed yourself the best way. So Pulkit, what's your take on that? Why PGDM? So,
I'll tell you something. So when I was graduating, I have been reading books. Not novels, but books as in my books. And I was really bored of those, because I know, okay, books are important. They will give you what is written there, but it won't give you an exposure to meet people, to understand how they operate and how you want to operate in future. It will just tell you, okay, these are the steps which is written in the book, you just follow. But let me tell you, whatever is written in the books will never come in use when you are in corporate. It is altogether a different ball game. It's altogether a different scenario.
That's true.
And if you think that, okay, I'm a graduate now, I know a lot of things and I can start my career with corporates, yes, you can, but it will take years to climb up the ladder and reach a position that you aspire to. So you always need a backup, you always need a support, and you always need a specialization wherein you can say, okay, I know a lot of things, but I'm master of one. And that is where I want to focus, and that is where I want to move. And while deciding for PGDM, you always have to know what is your inclination. Like mine was finance, I always knew. And that's the reason I was exploring options. What will be the best possible course that will suit and will help me realize my dream in finance? It could be CA, it could be CFA, it could be anything. But every course has got their pros and cons. Some has got a lot of investment of time, be it money. Some has got a lot of studies to be done, put in a lot of hours. Some has got a practical exposure, like PGDM has got a practical exposure. You read books, but you don't mug up books. You understand the concept, you try to apply it. Right. And you do it in those 2 years through a lot of community services, you do a lot of projects. And that's what projects are for, basically. You learn, you apply, and you realize, okay, this is something I'm good at, I can do it. And then you start taking up steps towards that. And that was the first thing which attracted me towards PGDM. And instead of doing CA, CFA, I decided to go for PGDM, because I knew what I learned, I can apply there and then and test it and then go to the corporate and then do my work.
But with this, I think I also would like to add up, because I see a lot of nervousness and curiosity together from the students' end, that how will we be able to cope up and what should we do beforehand. Rather, Pulkit has rightly highlighted that this is the 2 years' time where you learn and test, you learn and practice, yeah. you learn and test. So yeah. that entire thing with which you need to come prepared is actually not required, but a lot of preparation goes in side by side in a practical way. So need not be very, furious about how should we do something. Of course, you're coming here to do something and we are here to offer a great help to you. Rashmi, I have a question here. In fact, from the three of you, this question is from Archit. He wants to ask that as all three of you are from different domains, so what things should we consider before choosing a particular domain?
So basically, before choosing for marketing, I can totally relate to this question, to be very honest, because initially when I started doing PGDM, I came up with the mind that I'll be doing it in HR because my sister has done it in HR. So you always, go back to your sisters or your relatives if you have seen people. So I came up with the idea that I'll be doing it in HR after a year when we go to the internship. You go to the, corporate world, and that's your, not first, but I would say first practical, interaction with the corporate world. I did it in HR with Videocon. And I came back from my internship and I was like, no, I'm going to change it and I'm going to do it in marketing. That's where I want to be. So I don't want to say that you guys have to come with the mindset that I am going to do it in finance, in marketing, or in HR. It's good to know that you want to do it in finance or if you want to do it in marketing, but there is a possibility that you will change your mind the way I have done it. And I'm happy that I did it. I mean, I changed it. I chose marketing instead of HR. Nothing against HR here. So don't kill me, Avantika, but I don't know. After my internship, I just decided to go ahead with marketing. So I would suggest, like Pulkit said, you try here and then you test it, as in you go through it and then you decide whether you want to do it or no. So yeah. I would say start your journey, understand, and then decide. I mean, you have time. It's not from the day one you have to decide that you're going to do it in marketing or you're going to do it in HR or in finance. You can change your mind. I mean, initially you just started and then you decide. You can decide afterwards. You can decide after your internship, like I did. So, yeah.
And as it is their entire first year, they would be studying all the three specializations.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So, Avantika, what is your take on that? Should someone pre-decide or how to decide the domain? Well, I think there's some network lag there. So Pulkit, you can take the lead.
Absolutely. So see, first year, you rightly said, first year is to create that base to understand where my interest lies. Some of them already have a predefined notion.
We should not pre-decide because...
Some of them actually have a pre-notion that, okay, I want to do finance irrespective of what the scenarios are. But the first year will actually tell you, okay, I'm good at marketing. Be it back of my mind, I knew, okay, I wanted to do finance. But when you studied marketing, you liked it, you innovated, you did projects which actually were appreciated, and you have an inclination towards marketing. So first year basically will give you an opportunity to understand your true inclination and then give you an opportunity to decide what specialization you want to do, rather than just pre-deciding, okay, I want to do finance and then concentrating there. Without realizing your potential was actually
marketing.
Yeah, you
never know. Yeah, exactly. You never know. Maybe you, the way I have started with HR and then after my internship, I decided, no, it's marketing for me. Maybe you come up with a pre-notion that you want to do it in finance, which is a good thing, but maybe you will change your mind. So it's okay. Yeah, I think, first year will give you the immense opportunity to decide where you want to go. Be it HR, finance, or marketing.
Right. So there's a related question from Yash. I would ask this from you, Vantika, that what goals should we set for ourselves, particularly for the first year of our PGDM program?
First year, when we actually start our journey with the PGDM, our focus to understand what's actually going around, because there are lecturers who will tell us about examples of their life, because a couple of them have come from the corporate world and probably were, so probably we have to learn that. Secondly, our focus should be to understand that how we have to present ourselves to the outside world. So like stage fear. So I also have a stage fear. And but there, whenever the ma'am used to call us, I was happy to go there. Yes, she will tell me where I'm lacking, but actually she'll also tell me that how I can improve. So people should also take that as an opportunity, rather than feeling that how people will feel about me, they'll say that I don't know this much also. But that's fair. That's okay, because this is the time that we learn. Because as long as we start growing in our career, we will not be able to do this when we enter into the corporate world. Nobody will be able to give you that chance there. Mm-hmm. So this is the best time for us to learn. And starting 1 year, you should focus on your overall development, both personality and your personal development. So that should be the focus for the first year.
Great. I think very rightly mentioned, because that sets a base for your second year and then you go for your internship. So invest your time wisely into your overall development, be it personal or skill based or technical development. Now I come to the most favorite part of the students, which always excites them, which is their Oxford trip, as they call. So nowadays international exposure has become a must for anyone in the corporate world or even in the business world. So how beneficial was your experience, the entire stint at Oxford Business College? And talking about the same, did it add any relevance to your personal and professional development? I would request all three of you to give your views on that.
Absolutely. I'll take this because I got the benefit of it. So I'll tell you, when I joined Blackstone, I was previously assigned Singapore as my territory. But then they realized, okay, because there was a one-on-one interview going on with my director at Singapore, and I was back in India. And there was one-on-one just talking session going on with him. And I told him, okay, I did my PGDM. I also went to UK for my certification and all those things. So he realized, okay, you went to UK. You have a visa to UK. I was like, I had a visa to UK, but yes, I have been there. Oh, you have been to UK. And I don't know for what reason, but they require someone who has already visited London to operate for the UK business. Okay. So that, you know, whenever they want someone to go to UK, they can just directly send them, because once you have a visa to UK, it becomes easier for the companies also to get the visas. Right. So they directly shifted me from Singapore to UK for 3 months. I got trained. I went to UK for another 15 days. I came back and then I was again shifted to Singapore. So they just wanted, someone who has already been to UK to just go take the download, come back to India, train people, and then shift back to Singapore. So that was one opportunity that I believe I got it because I went to UK on the Oxford trip.
I think no one would have got a better opportunity than what you got, Pulkit.
For sure.
It was more like a star in the wing. What about you, Rashmi? How was your entire experience?
I think it was a very different experience, because that was my, I would say, first international interaction and the first presentation in front of totally different set of people. But it was very important for us to understand how corporate world is outside India also, so it wasn't just about corporate experience, it was also about cultural experience that we face in our organization. Because currently I'm working with Samsung and you have different nationalities here. So I would say that international trip somehow helped us in, understanding how the culture, other cultures operate. So yeah, in terms of the presentation, I would say that was the first interaction meeting with the international alumni or lecturers. And cultural wise also, I would say it helped me in developing and understanding the, different culture and different culture people.
Right, great. Atika, what about you? How was your experience there?
Ma'am, as Rashmi said, rightly, it was our first international trip. And because before that, if somebody would have gone, it's basically with parents that people visit. But probably in my case, it was the first international trip because I never went before. So it was a great experience to visit, and that's especially London, UK, that we're talking about, Oxford. So great learning that we got during the course, and there we did primary research as well, because there were topics that were assigned to us, and we had to actually get the directly feedback from people who are UK nationals, and we were talking to them, so we had to explain them what is the reason that you are doing the survey.
Yeah, we did the survey there. That was a very new thing. I mean, that was very raw from our side, you know, not knowing the market, our requirement, not knowing the people. Yeah.
Yes.
So it was very new, very different, but yeah, very good.
Yeah.
Great. Okay.
So that actually added a lot of learning, and we got that confidence that yes, we can talk to different cultural people as well. So that confidence actually, it boosted our confidence. So that was the good part.
Surely. Great. So I would like to know, this is from Gunika, Kangsha and Anushka, that during your tenure at ABS, what major transition did you observe in yourself, and what skills were you able to develop your best? And let's see what Rashmi has got to say on that.
Oh, I have so many, I would say. Okay. I'll start with the public speaking. I wasn't very good at it, I would say. I wasn't very keen doing things. But I think most of the events, I handled it. Because, of course, Pulkit is the one who pushed me, go ahead and do it. So, yeah. So, most of the anchoring and most of the event, I presented. And again, it's not just your friends, your, you know, lecturers, they push you to do things. So yeah, public speaking was my biggest fear. And I did too many anchorings. I did events posting, be it formal event, be our own fest. So I overcame that. And then for sure, because interviews are a very big part of, you know, the moment you step into the corporate world. So business communication lectures were very important in developing our skills, how to, you know, interact with the corporate world or the interviewees, how you need to be presentable. So those two, I would say, but I have a lot many which I have, you know, overcame during that point of time. So yeah.
Well, nobody would ever agree or believe that you once had a public speaking fear, looking at you today, for sure.
Yeah, and she is marketing expert now.
Exactly.
I credit goes to you too then.
Great, great. So Avantika, what has been your transition or biggest transition?
One, I would say, yes, public speaking, because yes, I had stage fear, probably because I never participated in any event in my school and college. So that was one I never was able to overcome. But I took this as an opportunity for myself to move up. Second, the management of various events was something that we could learn there. Because whenever, I still remember, there were events in AFT and we were actually managing the entire program or a particular event. So that actually helped us in learning how to manage things when we are just, we don't have any experience, we are zero there. And then you are given a responsibility. Okay, you need to manage this, do it the way you want. And then you actually brainstorm and think, okay, if we do this way, we do that way, this would be better. So our thinking starts from there. So that was another thing that I learned, and I'm thankful for that.
Great, great. So we have, you know, very competitive students in this batch. Here have the next question. They want to ask, this question is coming from Sonia and Anjali. They want to know, what did you do differently from your peers to get the best placement? So who would like to answer that? The real secret.
Wow, that's a very tricky question, I would say. What did we do different? Okay. Pulkit, I think you should answer it first.
Okay, so I'll tell you something. When I was in my specialization, when I was learning finance, what I could see in my peers, they were not really interested in reading news. And that was something that I loved. Okay, I used to read a lot of news, Economic Times, Mint, and all those newspapers. And I was pretty much, you know, up to my facts. Okay, this company is doing this, this company is doing that. And I still do that. I still read newspapers. Right. I love it. So that was something that I used to do differently. And when we appeared for the interviews, there are two challenges when you appear for an interview. One, the interviewer is going to take you for a ride because they know their domain, they know their job, and they know what they're hiring for, what they're looking for. They are going to take you for a ride. Now, the challenge would be how fast can you move it towards your, you know, towards you, towards the questions that you want to answer. And that could only happen when you know about things around you. If you just know books, right. You know the formula of percentage, you know the ratio analysis, you go and talk about that, that is not going to help. You have to drive the conversation to what you are comfortable, and that can only be done when you know things. Mm-hmm. So I believe that was something that helped me cracking the interviews at best of the firms. And even till now, when I was interviewing for Coca-Cola, that was the one thing that helped me a lot. Having to know about, you know, the surrounding, having to know about your domain, especially, it will always help. And that was something that has helped me during my college days as well.
I think that is a very, very important point, because you start your conversations, you know, even when you're trying to network, you're building small talk, or you want to extend conversations with people. This is how you lively interact and network with them properly. So being very aware about what is happening is, of course, so I think students, you've got a trick to that. How to excel and leave others behind, is this the way? So this question would be from Avantika, being from the HR domain. This question comes from Utkarsh, Yash, and Archit. What must we start preparing for job interviews and college placements? How do we decide which company would be the best for our first job? And what does the company look for in a fresher while hiring?
So let's start with the first question. How you should prepare for an interview, you have to be confident while presenting your views. Mm-hmm. Because interviewers actually catch you there. Because if you are nervous, if you are manipulating things, they will catch you there and they'll roll around it and ask you as many possible questions as they can. And they will make you feel that you don't know what we are asking. So you should be very much confident. And there are times, it has happened with me also, that I wasn't sure what the answer is. So I was very open and candid in telling them, sorry, I don't know this. Because that's the easier way to tell the other person, see, I don't know this, but I'm happy to learn. And you should always show it in a manner that whatever comes through, you will make sure that you are doing an excellent job. So that's one thing that I like about myself, and probably have been appreciated by my seniors, that I never give up. There are many things I don't know, but I always try and learn. And that you should keep it in your mind, because nobody has come in this world who knows 100%. Mm-hmm. Yeah. There's always a scope of learning in every one of us. So we, our colleagues, our lecturers, maybe there are times our siblings as well, younger siblings. We should learn from them as well. So that is the overall mindset that you should have, that you should never give up learning and be confident in whatever you say. Second, during the interview, what you should prepare for is, as Pulkit said, yes, bookish knowledge is important, but you should be up to date to the real market as well, that what's going on in the real market. If I talk about HR is not only related to recruitment currently or payroll. It is a very wide gamut. So probably in corporates, people think that HR's job is so easy. They just have to interview people, hire them, and process the payroll. But nobody, it's not that easy. You have to be always on your toes to see what's going around and how to make your employees happy. So you have to be always thinking something different, which makes them feel happy about the place that they are working. So you have to be very much aware that what's different that you can do for yourself and the people around you, and that will help you to actually enrich yourself also in the longer run. Any question that I missed?
No, all three of them have been covered. Thank you so much for answering that. I think they are so ambitious that before even starting the college, they're so focused towards the placement. So who best than an HR and the HR manager could have answered this. Next, I have this question from Pulkit. Pulkit, how important do you think are co-curricular activities along with academics? How did the skills learned both inside and outside the classroom translated into your career progression? So this is by Shubhankar and Saurabh. And also, I would like to know, how was your experience, of the events like Keshe and Athlima, which I'm sure you people must have been part of?
Yes.
Pulkit, you are on.
Pulkit, I'm sorry. So I'll tell you, the events that we used to organize, those were the base for us to, work in a team. That was the challenge, because, these events were huge. There were a lot of people involved, different activities. And I still remember Keshe and Athlima. We were the first batch who, started all these events. So we actually helped making this event successful. A set of our colleagues and set of our team that was working majorly around these activities. So first I'll say these activities, majorly the projects, the presentation, and all these events, they actually help you understand how to organize something. Time management is something that will be of essence. How to resolve conflict between your teammates. Trust me, there would be, when you are working with different set of people, different set of minds, there are going to be conflicts. Yeah. And you have to be very proactive in resolving that, because if you can't do that, you can't be actually a good manager, because then it will always haunt you. So these activities actually created a base for us to understand how we can tackle these situations when we are in corporate. Mm-hmm. And trust me, in corporate also, you are going to face these kind of situations. Be it with your colleagues, teammates, be it with your managers, be it with your juniors, seniors, anywhere. These kind of situations would be there, and you have to handle those. And these projects, these presentations, these events will actually guide you how you can do that. So I believe that has actually helped me a lot.
Great. So there's a student named Utkarsh who wants to know that, are there any additional courses or extracurricular, co-curricular activities that one must do during these 2 years apart from what college offers? Should they take up certain, courses or certifications or any additional activity that they should involve themselves in?
If we specifically talk about finance, it keeps on evolving. I won't say what I have learned 7-8 years back is still relevant. It has evolved a lot. Nowadays, if I look finance as a function, it's not only about numbers, it's more about analytics, it's more about creating insights. Mm-hmm. And that's the reason what I feel, okay, PGDM will give you the base, will give you all the information that you need, will give you a start. But as in when you grow in your career, you will always want to upgrade yourself. So initially, you would need to create that base, understand what finance as a function is. Mm-hmm. And then as per your inclination, you can take up n number of diploma courses that are available. But then you need to decide what is your inclination. Like for me, I always wanted to be a consultant. So mm-hmm. I'm working towards that. So someone would like to be, someone who would like to be into financial research. Mm-hmm. Then they would need to take up courses which are related to research. Someone would like to be in financial risk analysis. Then right. FRM is kind of a diploma, kind of a certification that they would like to take up. So it will highly depend in what kind of environment you are working, what kind of job profile you have. Mm-hmm. And after that, you need to decide. But initially, PGDM would be more than enough to start your career in finance at least.
Great. So there's a student, Dhruv, who wants to know, where did you do your first job and what are the problems that you faced? How did you overcome it and rise so high? So Rashmi, if you could answer this.
All right. So I started my first job with Hindustan Field Services. It's a joint venture between Unilever and Smolin, which is a South African company. It's more about retail operations, retail marketing, and how the entire retail operations work. So my difficulty started because for this job, I had to move out to Mumbai. Mm-hmm. So that was like moving out of, your house and going to a totally different city. So my difficulty started from there, and totally fresh, totally naive, doesn't know anything about the corporate world. City is new, people are new, everything is new. So in a way it helped me, you know, understanding everything, you know, how to manage things, how you need to manage, micromanage things, you know, meeting different culture people, different city people, how their lifestyle is. I know the lifestyle of Delhiites, Delhi people or North India. So it would have been very easy for me if I, you know, started my journey in Delhi, because I moved out to Mumbai, people are different, weather is different, you know, their lifestyle is different. And because I'm working in marketing, being such a diverse country, India, and, you know, moving out to a new city helped me a lot in, you know, in understanding different culture in India, because I didn't stop there. I moved from Mumbai to Hyderabad to Pune to other cities to understand, you know, how the lifestyle is different, how marketing is different in every culture, how we localize our advertisement. So I think my difficulty started then and there the moment I moved out, but in a way it helped me in, you know, understanding that marketing is not just about one place. It is about the entire thing. So I think in this journey, at every step you learn and you overcome, because you learn it, you have to change every difficulty into your learning and then, you know, implement those learnings in your experience. So I think definitely it was difficult part, but it was a very beautiful journey that turned into a very beautiful learning for me. So yeah, I would say,
great lesson here for sure, that it is important to move out of your comfort zone to be successful.
It is.
Isn't it? Great. So there's a student named, in fact, two students, Mayank and Pradyuman, they would want to know, has pandemic brought about a change in the corporate world? Should we prepare ourselves differently for that? Anybody could pull in? Yeah.
Absolutely. There are a lot of changes. We don't take 2020 as a normal year anymore. It is completely different. It has, you know, changed everything for the corporate. I'll tell you something. When I was working with JP Morgan, pandemic started. And JP Morgan being a bank, they would never allow their employees to work from home. Because whenever we used to go and request, okay, sir, we would like to work from home for a day or two, they used to say, oh, we have serious data security, we can't let you work from home. And as soon as pandemic started, the whole service was brought down to India and everyone was working from home suddenly. So it has changed everything for the corporate. Now they are really flexible when it comes to working. It is not your 9-to-5 regular job. You go to office, you work, you come back. You can work from anywhere. They just want your results. So pandemic has changed the way of working, but it has not changed the work actually.
Work, right. Right. I think that we need to become more adaptable, you know, as an individuals now to be very open to change. That is one thing needs to change. Yes, Avantika, I think you wanted to share something with us.
Actually, I wanted to say the same that Pulkit said, because as an HR also, my company also, because we had a lot of data that was related to personal information of people, and we were not allowed to work from home, especially the operations folks. But with this, we have completely evolved to a new hybrid model where we are allowing a lot of folks to permanent work from home, and many of them have opted as well. So it has changed the mindset of the employers as well, wherein they have started thinking that, yes, people can work from home, we can give them that leverage, we can give them that comfort zone to work. But yes, rightly said by Pulkit, it is not just a 9-to-5 or a 9-to-6 job. It is actually a 9-to-9 job where you can be expected to complete your task, take your own time, but this has to be done. So yes, I would say the work has increased, but parallelly, we have also got I would say, some comfort wherein we can manage our work at our own pace and not to move to office on a regular way, just come out, but given a mindset where we are able to manage our work also and our personal life as well. So yes, it's a change, and probably all of us and companies across the globe have started thinking that way. So yes, we all should be adaptive, and we should be happy to change ourselves the way the world requires us to.
Right.
And it has its pros and cons, I guess.
Yes, Rashmi, sorry, I interrupted.
I was just saying that it has its pros and cons. So I would say that corporate has become more flexible. Yeah. But yeah, our working timing has been stretched. And if you're talking about the demand in the, you know, organization, I would say it slowed down for a while, but I think it is still picking up and there will be demand. So yeah.
Right. That's what I was saying. I think hoping for the years ahead to be graceful and grateful. So these students, by the time they would get placed, they would probably work in the conventional way or the conventional manner from their desks and the offices. Great. So there's another question from Ridhima and Gunika, and not just them. I think so many students messaged us and wanted to know about the work-life balance. How does the work-life balance look like, and how do you manage your time? They have not started working, but they want to balance their lives from now itself. What's your take on that?
I think that should be your least of concern as of now, because initially it is very important that you focus on your learnings. Your learning should be your priority. Definitely after a certain point of time, when you excel your skills, mm-hmm. you will have the work-life balance. But I would say it is very important. I'm not saying that it is not important, but prioritize your learnings first.
Yes.
Right. And
I believe the corporates nowadays take care of your work-life balance.
Yeah,
they will always get your weekends for yourself so you can manage that. But if you're expecting that it's a 9-to-5 job, I should come back home by 5, you can't do that. You have to, there are times
you will get used to it. The moment you get used to it. Yeah, you'll get used to it. I mean, initially when we started working from home, it was so annoying and frustrating because we are so habitual of, you know, going to office and working, but now you're used to it. So work-life balance and everything, you will get used to it for sure.
You will find out ways for that.
Yeah, exactly.
Probably, when we start working, we actually start realizing that this is our responsibility and ownership to get the work done. And it's there in our minds also that we just don't want to shut down our system at 5 or 6 and we say, okay, we are done. Because we know that this is our responsibility and we have to complete it. Maybe it takes 12 hours a day and maybe it takes just 2 hours a day. So there are times when you will see that you have limited work, and there will be time when you will see that I'm so exhausted, and then also you have a lot of list that you have to complete. So you actually start getting that into your own self, that where you have to put in your personal life into front end and where you have to put your professional life. So you yourself get to understand how to balance between both of them.
I think there's so much sense of maturity that is coming out from the all three of you, how beautifully you are managing your work in life together. Next question is from Yash, and I think a very, very intellectual and smart question rather. Is it helpful for the career growth? And exactly, I see in the live chat box as well for the students asking about this, that what should we prioritize? Should we prioritize a good package or a good company or a good profile? And also Yash wants to know, is it helpful for the career growth to switch the companies after some time rather than staying in one company for a long time? So I think I will take all three of yours opinion on that. Yes. So,
ma'am, if you ask me, then my preference would be towards the work profile rather than package or the company. Because initially when we are starting our career, learning is most important for all of us. The more we learn, the more we get knowledge at our initial job, package and good companies will start following us. Because when you are good in terms of your own professional knowledge, you can get everything. And so my priority would be good profile and something that you are interested in doing. Second, switching jobs. I would say it is good to switch job, only when you see that you are not getting the role or learning that you wanted. So right. On 11th of August this year, I will be completing 6 years with my organization, which actually is a, I would say it's a good number that I'm completing this year. But the only thing that actually forced me to stay in this company was I started as a recruiter, then I started working for payroll, then I started working as business partnering role. And now I can handle anything and everything in HR, be it performance management, employee retention, anything that we talk about. So I saw my learning here, my growth path here, where I started when I had just 1.5 years of experience, and today I'm sitting at 7.5 years of experience. The learning is most important thing that you should consider. But if you see that you are into a monotonous job and there's no role change for you, you can't learn something new. And when you start thinking that this is your comfort zone, that's the right time that you should start thinking of moving on. Because if you get stuck there, it will be very difficult for you to move out and face the competition around. Because actually, I think about myself also whenever I go for interviews, I think that will I be able to answer all the questions that are there in the market? Because I haven't changed my company for 6 years now. Many right. things have changed in the corporate world. In other companies, people are thinking of different mindset. But I will have to prepare myself parallelly with my own knowledge and that is there in the market, both together, to make myself at that level. But my only suggestion with all the new folks will be that whenever you see that there is no learning for you in the current role, please start looking out and move to a role that you're interested. If you get into a comfort zone, it will be very difficult for you to change and then face a new challenge, because whenever you change a new company, starting 3-4 months would always be challenging for you, because you experience new culture, you meet new people, you see new business, and the expectations are always way higher than what you think that you can do. So you will always have to keep yourself boosted. No, I can do this, I can do that. So you have to be very much competitive. The mindset that you have should always be there, that yes, I can do it. That's very much important, that I would say.
Right. Pulkit, just one question. This has come from Shubham. He wants to know, how do you push yourself through your worst times?
Okay, that is interesting. See, there would be challenges coming across when you're working. And being in corporate, you will always be asked something that you might have never done it before. So it would be a new challenge. Now, whenever I face such kind of situation, I know if I can complete it, this is going to add to my skills. Mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure of that. And that is the motivation. That is the drive force that, you know, takes me forward. I know okay, I'm adding something to my skill. I am going to do it. Whether I know it, well and good. If I don't know it, I have to learn it. Being in an industry which is very diversified and, you know, changes rapidly, you have to keep yourself updated any which way. Otherwise, you are going to be redundant. Mm-hmm. And if you want to be updated, you have to take up challenges. It is going to be stressful, but you can always manage. You can always tell yourself, okay, if I'm going to do this and it comes out to be good, it is going to add a skill to my resume. It is going to add a skill to myself, which I will again go ahead and will again project it and sell myself to some other company for a better package, and I will start working there. So it always helps.
I think Pulkit has got another skill set on his back, that he can be a good motivational speaker and got good tricks to, you know, help students excel in life and at least in the corporate world.
Thank you.
Great. So this question comes from Atul. Human always resist change. How to handle this during college as well as the corporate life?
Rashmi, you want to take it or I should take it?
Up to you. I would say it is very important to change with the time. It's mm-hmm. very important to adapt changes. Otherwise, you will become obsolete. Mm-hmm. So I think don't consider change as something you should not look forward to. I would say take it in a positive way. It is another opportunity that you can add on to, and it is very important in today's world. Even if you look at the marketing, if you go back in like 5 or 10 years back, there was nothing on social media. Nobody was talking about it. look at it now, like people are earning so much. It's a change. People adapted to it. And I mean, they are a good professionals now. So I think it's very important to adapt changes so that you don't become obsolete, I would say.
Right. With this, there's a interconnected question has come from Ajaspi, that what were the challenges you people have faced to reach this height? I'm sure there are many. We have spoken about a few as of now. So if one of you can be specific about it.
I can talk about my field basically. The first challenge that I faced while coming up majorly was my skills that were, you know, not up to the mark, and I have to upgrade myself. So I had colleagues who have never thought of upgradation and they are still there. I was always thinking about upgrading my knowledge. I could climb the ladders fast. So one would be your skill set that you would always need to upgrade. Second challenge would be how well you manage with people around you. If you can network properly, if you can convince people properly, if you can talk to them, you know, if you can drive insights out of those talks and you can convince people around you, it would be really helpful and it won't be a bigger challenge to climb ladders in corporate.
Great. Yes, very well said. I think we also focus here on the people skills, which probably overdo the technical skills in the long run, and students get really a lot of help from these climbing up the corporate ladder. So this question comes from Sabha, and I think this is there on everybody's mind. It's more like a curtain raiser which you people are doing to the corporate world. So she wants to know, what is the work environment like in the corporate world? How would you describe the culture? Of course, it would be specific to your regions and companies that you belong to, but overall, what is the corporate culture like?
Competitive, for sure.
Yeah.
Okay, Avantika, what do you have to say on that?
As Pulkit said, it is competitive. So you will have to create a different image for yourself. You should always have a differentiating factor in you, which actually is easily able to segregate you from the others that are there. Because these days, if you think that you are at a pleasant job, living a 9-to-6 job, you're getting whatever earnings that you are happy with. But if you don't do something new and don't add anything new to your profile, at some point in time, you start becoming obsolete. And that's the time when you will realize that you are no longer required in the organization. So organization culture, I would say it is yes dependent on how you handle people and how the organization handles their employees, but at the same time, say no organization is bad, no organization is good. It's only about how you feel about people and how you think about the things that are going in the organization. There are times that you yourself can take an initiative and improve the culture. And there are times then you will say that, no, I don't wish to, and I have to just move out. So corporate culture, it's very much important these days, because employees look towards it and organizations are putting a lot of focus on it. But you should always be open to face anything that's coming in front of you, because if you give up, then you are nowhere around. So probably you will have to focus on that.
Right, great. I think you mentioned it very rightly, and probably students should ponder upon this point, that what is unique about you. And with that, you need to start identifying who you are, you know, enhancing your self-awareness. And we have actually started their journey from this point only. They're having sessions with us, knowing themselves, who they are, what their strengths are, what their weaknesses are, probably, which helps them, you know, draft their career ahead. So we have a couple of questions which are related to the domain. Some students are, you know, very specific and interested in a specialization. So let's start with finance, Pulkit. So the first question is, what key skills should a student possess to excel in the financial domain and make a good career?
All right. So first and the foremost and the basic would be Microsoft Excel. You should know that. That is first and the foremost.
I think that is applicable in every field.
Every domain. Yeah. Okay. Apart from that, you should have eye for detail when it comes to finance. You should be able to speak to numbers. You should be able to make sense out of them. Mm-hmm. Finance is not accounting. Let me tell you this. So there are people who get confused about finance and accounting. Accounting is different. Finance is different. Mm-hmm. Finance is a very, very vast domain. Accounting comes under finance. So to excel in finance, I would say, one, you should be well aware of basic financial applications. Second, you should be well aware, you should be able to understand the financial impact of a number on an organization. Mm-hmm. You should be having eye for details. When you look at numbers, you should be able to create a history of that number, how you appeared to that number, how that number came to your books. So you should be aware of that. You should be aware about the surroundings, your competing companies, how their finance department works, how their numbers are produced. You should be interested in learning those. You should be well aware of the markets. And it is not only the market that you operate in. You should be aware of the markets, which is not related to you, but you should have a knowledge about, okay, how that market operates. You should be very much aware of the financial terms. If you don't understand some terms and you are sitting in a meeting with your finance directors, they would be using those terms and you would be blank. And it has happened with me when I started my career and when I used to go into the meetings, and every organization's finance department would love to keep the meetings. Trust me on this. They want to discuss each and every number. And when I was at my initial stages, I didn't know a few of the terms and I was like sitting like this. Okay, I need to understand what exactly it means. So you should develop that insight. You should develop that knowledge base. There are n number of websites on Google. You just type financial acronyms and it will give you a list. Try and read one or two every day, and you will start accumulating that financial vocabulary. What is beta? What is alpha? These are the very basic acronyms, but you will use it day in, day out when it comes to finance.
Mm-hmm. Right. So with this, I think, of course, their coming 2 years, they would be gaining a lot of knowledge. And at their individual level, also students can keep researching about things. But Pulkit, does it mean that a student who does not have a mathematical background or is not good with numbers or maths should not pursue finance? Is that true?
I would absolutely say this. I was from a non-mathematics background. Okay. I have done my mathematics only till 10th standard, and after that I have never taken maths as a subject. I hated it because I never understood tan theta, cos theta, sin theta. It was above my head. For finance, you would need only 5 applications: plus, minus, divide, percentage, and multiplication. That's it. If you know these 5, you are good to go for finance. Finance is more how you operate these 5 applications into your numbers. Mm-hmm. That's it. If you can build an insight of those numbers, you're good for finance. You don't have to be a maths expert. You just need to be expert in understanding numbers. That's it. So if you are not from a maths background, nothing to worry about. You can always take finance.
Great. Okay, so Avantika, let's move on to HR related questions. This question is from Rashi and Ayushi, that we are looking forward to HR as a domain specialization. So what all new career options are available for the students with reference to the current scenario?
See, like I said previously, HR initially was thought just a recruitment and a payroll job where you hire people, you pay their salaries and the month goes on. Mm-hmm. But currently, with the recent movement and recent upgradation and evolution of HR, there mm-hmm. are a lot of things that have evolved in the market. Like there is a new role of compensation and benefits, there are business partnering role, there are performance management, employee retention. Employee engagement these days is a very, very different segment of HR. There's a lot of focus on. So you have to be very much prepared for it. So HR, if I say you, if you ask me, you should not decide well in advance that where you want to go specific into HR. First target should be to get into an HR profile and then gradually decide where you want to move on. Because if you get into a corporate HR, you will get exposure of recruitment also. You will have people who are working in comp and ben. You will have people who are working in payroll. So if you show up that willingness and zeal to learn, you can go up to your team members and ask, sir, how this is done, ma'am, how this is done, and you can learn. And from there, you can actually understand what is the role that interests you. And mm-hmm. then you pursue your career thereafter. So first, your main target should be to enter into a profile of HR and then start learning about other fields into HR and think where you want to grow. So if you ask me, initially, almost 4 years of my life, I spent into recruitment. And then I actually, there was a time when I thought that, no, this is not something that helping me or is of interest anymore, and I want to learn something new. So there was a point in time when I wanted to resign from the organization, but when I discussed it with my manager, my colleagues, they were like, okay, you have interest into this, so rather than going into a new organization and they giving you that opportunity, why not let's start learning it internally and then grooming you up to that level. So that actually helped me, that along with recruitment, which was a main forte of my role, but I learned other things as well. And probably I would say that's the reason that I can currently handle all the things. Yes, I would say I'm not 100% there, but there was always a scope to learn. I can learn from a director. Google is the best friend as of date. We can learn everything in Google. So probably I would say first we should start getting into a job into HR and then start exploring the different segments of HR.
Right. There is a live question here which has come from Jay Krishna. He is saying that I had completed my graduation back in 2016. So it has been a very long time that I have been close to academics. So how should I overcome that lag now that he is starting PGDM with us? So anything that can be done? Yeah.
I feel if you are taking a PGDM, trust me, it is not about books. So you're not going to face any difficulty when it comes to a courses like this, which has got more practical implications and applications rather than reading the notes and giving exams and then excelling it. It would be more of, you know, how practically you have utilized those concepts that you have learned during your class sessions, during your projects, and during your presentations. So I would tell you with my experience, when I was writing exams back in ABS, me and my friend used to stay in a flat and we never used to study. We used to write exams basis what we have learned during our presentations, during our class sessions. We used to just write exams basis that. We never opened the book and read, but I'm not saying you should not. But yeah, that will actually won't deter you if you have not been into studies for a few years. PGDM won't stop you and won't actually be that difficult to take up.
Even
books
people
again.
Who are pursuing PGDM, they come from the different background. There are people like who doesn't have the management degree before, so it's not something that should stop you. Just go ahead and learn, and yeah, you can cope up with the gap that you have.
Right.
Okay. So I think here, ma'am, is that 2 years of time of our PGDM is basically like a training for us, preparing us for the corporate world. And we all should actually utilize this time to groom ourselves, develop ourselves, along with study for sure. But it should be taken as a training where you actually get up with your weaknesses and actually come up as a personality which is easily acceptable and sellable in the market. So it should be taken as a training period for you rather than just a two-year curriculum course that you have to go through.
Mm-hmm. Great. So Rashmi, some questions related to marketing. This has come from Sanjana. She wants to know that marketing is the vast domain, and under this umbrella, you have n number of options to choose from. So how do you get to pick and choose the right one?
That's a very good question. And I think I had same kind of a doubt when I was stepping into the corporate world. Mm-hmm. So it's very vast. It's changing every day. And it's very important that you update yourself. Mm-hmm. So her question is about how she should pick it up and pick the option of the market.
Right.
So I think initially you should start. So basically you need to do the background study about it. I did the same thing because people usually come up with I want to be a brand manager. I want to be a marketing manager. So don't come up with the you know, preconceived notion that this is what marketing is about. It is very important that you have the, you know, field knowledge. So how you want to pick it, it's a later stage question. It is very important that you start with the, you know, field knowledge, with the basic knowledge, and then you develop yourself. So I started as a management trainee. And of course, I had this concept that I want to be a brand manager. But how do you want to, you know, reach to that level? That I had to, you know, understand. And then I decided with my journey, I decided how I will, you know, crave the path to become something. So yeah. I would recommend the same thing. You can come up with the concept that this is where I want to be, because we have brand management, then we have marketing management, we have BTL, ATL, we have online, so many things. It is very, I mean, it's good that you're coming up with one thing, that I want to be an online marketer. Then what you can do, you can, with your management course, you can have another course to, you know, update yourself with the online skills. But I would say, open yourself initially with all the, you know, opportunities that you get, because that's very important. Yeah.
We have one last question in this section from Vivek. What kind of challenges, or are there any challenges that you face in the modern marketing system? Looking at this domain evolved, you know, so much. So are there any particular challenges?
There are many challenges. I would say every field has challenges. Mm-hmm. So, right, there are people who doesn't have background. I don't have background in online marketing, and it's booming right now. But that's not, that shouldn't be your concern, because you can always go back to, you know, studies, and you can upgrade your skills. Mm-hmm. So there are many challenges. In marketing, it is very important that if it's a pool of, you know, talented people, when you go out, it's a market of talented people. And if you want to stand out, it is very important that you upgrade yourself. I still do courses. I still do study. I still go back, you know, and try to, you know, update myself. So, yeah, it's a part and parcel of life. It's very important if you want to stand out. Just keep yourself updated.
Right, great. So with this, we'll move to a very exciting segment of this alumni meet, where we're going to have a rapid fire at ABS round. So this is our very own special and unique round. I'm sure you must have seen it on coffee shows. So you are one of the celebs here now, sitting with us and having conversation with us. You know the rules already. You have to be quick, you have to be rapid, and you have to be very honest with that. So who do we start with first?
Pulkit.
Oh, no. I'm very bad at this.
For everything. Okay. So Pulkit, you're not allowed to take more than a second to answer, okay? Great.
Okay, I'll try my best.
Okay. So when you imagine yourself in 2012 and look at yourself today, what is that one change that has drastically come in you?
I can speak to anyone now.
Great. Your fondest memory at ABS?
I remember sitting in the auditorium looking at people speaking on the stage. I loved it.
Okay, you love that, sitting in the red room auditorium. Okay, which was your favorite corner in the college? Can't be the same answer.
Okay, it was my classroom, I would say. Because most of the time.
Very studious. Okay, how was your bond of you, yourself, with your faculty members?
It was very good. When I was getting married, I actually came to college to invite everyone. Mm-hmm. So I'm still in touch with all the faculty members.
Great. So if you could imagine yourself 8 years back, who would you identify yourself with? The notorious one, teacher's favorite, the last bencher, the leg puller, or man or woman for food?
Man or woman for food, I would be the man for food for sure.
Okay. Yes, of course, we were not asking you to decide between two. But man for food. Okay. As a student, how were you expecting your boss to be, and how is your boss in reality?
I was expecting someone who would give me leaves whenever I wanted, but it is not the reality.
Okay, great. What is the feeling like, or what was the feeling when you had your first penny in hand, which you had earned?
I would say I was really happy because now I knew I don't have to ask anyone before spending.
Okay, great. If given a chance to go back and relive, which phase of life would you prefer? School life, college life, or work life?
I would always love my college life. We used to sit at Sector 18 for coffees with my friends. So that was the best moment, I would say.
Great, great. Rank in order of preference or importance. Okay, money, fame, success.
I would say success, because money can always follow it. And if you
he's
have
a
money,
liar, fame, he's lying.
Fame would always come.
A finance person start with money, I'm sure. Yeah. He's all about digits.
Yeah.
Okay, so the honest answer now.
Okay, money, it is obviously the sign that you are successful. And if you are successful, fame would be there for you.
Okay, great. One last question. What comes to your mind when I say the following words? Time.
Money would be printing there.
Luxury.
If you have a car, a good house, I believe that is a luxury.
Friendship.
Everyone that I have been in touch till now.
Okay, career.
I'm still growing and I would like to grow as I'm growing as a
boss.
Boss, okay. That
he's not there online with us.
No, I would say someone who can hold my hand when I'm stuck somewhere.
Great. That was very nice. Well performed. So we don't have winners, but of course you did very well. Let's start with the ladies now. Rashmi. Okay, hey. Again, Rashmi, very quick and rapid. So okay. When you imagine yourself in 2012 and look at yourself today, what is that one big change you can drastically notice in yourself?
Maturity.
Maturity, great. Your favorite corner in college was?
My bench, my classroom.
Okay, your favorite faculty member?
There are too many.
Too
like
many.
I have to list down. Yeah, everyone okay. contributed in my development, everyone.
Okay, great. If you could imagine yourself 8 years back, would you? Who would you identify yourself with? The same options, the leg puller, the last bencher, teacher's favorite, the notorious one, and the woman for food?
Yes, notorious.
The notorious one. Okay, yeah. Great. I'm sure you've got stories with you. So as a student, how were you expecting your boss and how is your boss in reality?
I was expecting him to be rude, but trust me, every boss that I had and I have till now, they're very helpful.
Lucky one. Okay. Which moment of your life made you feel proud about yourself?
Again, there are too many. So I think my first promotion from management trainee to assistant manager. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's something we always look forward to. That first promotion is some sort of, you know, achievement. I think walking on the red carpet is the same thing, I would say.
Okay, so, yeah. Where did you spend your first income?
Clothes and coffee.
Okay, great. The girl's best friends.
Exactly. Okay.
So, if given a chance or if given a time machine, would you rather travel in past or move to future? And what would you do?
Oh, that's a very good question. if given a chance,
Pulkit
I will...
is here to tell you, you were not very quick in
yeah.
You were not very
rapid and quick with your
this
answer.
Was rapid
no, the
power,
last
yeah.
question is tricky, but it's a good one. So I want to think about it. But
okay, go
yeah.
ahead, answer. Yeah.
I think future.
Future. Okay, you want yeah. to know your future. Great. What mm-hmm. comes to your mind when I take the following words? Dream.
Comes true.
Relationships.
Very important.
Boss.
Good luck. No, I mean, come on. Don't do this,
diplomatic. Friendship.
Part of life.
Great. Okay. One thing that you love and hate about yourself.
I am diplomatic. That's
that
what
you
said.
Love or you hate?
So okay. I need to improve it a bit. And I think I am open to learn. That's what I like about me. So I still see myself somebody who is still learning. and will prefer to be like this. Yeah.
Fine. Okay, Rashmi, you still are on the second position, of course, because you were not very quick with your answers, but you were good. Thank you. Avantika, last one. HR, yeah. And we don't expect the HR to be diplomatic now, okay?
HRs are the most diplomatic people in the world.
They have to be. That's a job qualification.
Great. So let's start. Avantika, your best pastime would be?
Sitting with my friends and talking.
Okay. If given a chance to go back to your college days at ABS, one thing that you would definitely do?
I would want to go back to my classroom and have my all colleagues around and we are chit-chatting.
Okay. Your favorite corner in college was?
Probably the cafeteria or the pool table, I would say.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Your fondest memory at ABS?
When I actually got the in my badge. So that was a moment that I admire the most.
Okay, great. So again, the same question. Who do you identify with when I take the following names? I think I already know the answer. The notorious one, teacher's favorite, the last bencher, the lecturer.
I know the answer.
The woman for food. Okay, let's ask them first. What do they think?
Teacher's favorite.
It is teacher's favorite.
Even I think so. I guess so. Great. Okay, so if given a chance to go back and relive, which phase of life would you prefer? Yeah. School life, college life, or work life? I think we lost her voice.
Yeah, she can blame it to internet now.
Okay, college life. I'm on the second one now.
No, she's back with us. Yes, Avantika, what's your answer?
College life.
College life. Okay, rank in order of importance. Friends, career, family, personal well-being.
Family, friends, personal well-being, and then career.
Okay, great. What comes to your mind when I say the following word? Time.
Money.
Okay, boss.
Helpful whenever I'm stuck somewhere.
Okay, dream.
To have a happy life.
Favorite teacher?
That's a tricky one. Please don't ask.
Okay,
everyone was
listening. Okay, friendship?
Probably friends whom you can share anything and everything.
Wish?
To be successful in life and have everybody around me happy and satisfied.
Okay, great. One thing that you love and hate about yourself?
Hate, I am too emotional. I go with the flow. If somebody is upset, I usually try to help them the most that I can. Love about myself is that I never give up. I always try to manage situations that I am and try to cope up with it and bring myself as a new one. So mm-hmm. That's something that I like about myself.
Okay, great. And last question, who performed the best amongst the three of you?
Probably Pulkit, I believe.
Okay, great. Pulkit, so you are the winner to this, but we have a surprise for all three of you. I think we are highly, highly thankful and, very, very proud rather to host you here at ABS. And I'm sure that the students who have attended this session with us have, learned so much, have taken insights from your experiences. And this was a highly valuable session for them. They have not yet started their actual journey of academics with us, though they've started their development journey with us through a couple of competitions and events. This surely would be a milestone for them. And I think an eye opener, which ensured a lot of, vision and insights given to them about the corporate world, which was much needed. And listening to all three of you, the faculty members are also here on behalf of all of them, the management team. I thank you from the bottom of my heart and everybody else's pleasure. I would like to express that it was wonderful having the three of you here. To acknowledge your presence, we have a memento to present. So can we first have it for Rashmi?
Thank you so much.
So we're starting with Pulkit.
On my behalf.
For you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for this.
Can we have it for Rashmi as well?
Thank you so much. It was kind of reliving our days again. So yeah. Thank you for having us here.
Our pleasure. And for Avantika as well, please.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We look forward to stay in touch always. You are part of us and looking forward to host you very soon in college as well. Thank you once again.
I think all of us would like to tell you and the entire faculty members of ABS, thank you for giving us this opportunity to share our experience. Probably it's the first time that we all have done this. It's all our pleasure also to be here and to talk to you guys and tell you to be here. Secondly, one thing that I would want to tell all the people who are just starting their PGDM, please take your internship very seriously, because that's the time you actually learn a lot and you get to know that what will help you in your corporate world ahead. So please don't go there just for 2 months enjoying and just coming out of seriously, because it will actually help you growing in the ladder in your career. So please take that seriously. That one thing that I wanted to add.
Thank you so much, Avantika.
Avantika is now a perfect HR, I must say this.
Yeah.
I think all three of you are well ready to deliver webinars now and speak to students like these who will surely benefit from your talk.
Absolutely, we would be available if whenever they need it. We are on LinkedIn and everywhere they can reach out to us.
Definitely, students shall reach out. And thank you so much once again for your time and for your valuable time and efforts that you've put in. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Good day.